Hi everyone, this is Raghu and Mindrolling and our new edition this week features a very, very, very special person named Annie Lamott. I hope and think that most of you listening and watching will recognize her and know about her, especially if you follow her on Facebook. She's amazing, writes these excellent little essays reflecting our times, so astute that she is. And she is the most unique writer that I know. I mean, she's extraordinary in her abilities to really get across these concepts that are so necessary, especially in these times. And this new book of hers called Hallelujah Anyway, In Spite of It All. I like that, especially today's times, in spite of it all, hallelujah. Anyway, it's around the concept of mercy, which I didn't have much of a relationship with. And once she got into the definition of that term, related to kindness, related to compassion, related to love and caring, I have a whole new relationship with it now. And I think you will too when you listen to this. This is one of, to me, given the times we're in, it's just an exceptional a podcast in terms of what it is that she has to say and what this book is about, and gives me another opportunity to talk about support for the Be Here Now Network. Okay, we need it. And this is, of course, I've talked about the Amazon, the easiest way for you guys to support us is to get that link on BeHereNowNetwork.com and just copy and paste it into your bookmark bar. And whenever you need to buy something from Amazon, bang, there it is. You can easily click on that link and get whatever you want, and we get a few percent. I mean, it's really helpful. It's not a lot, but if a lot of people do it, then it goes a long way to supporting us. So go up there and get Annie's book, will you? It's Hallelujah Anyway. And otherwise, I urge you to take the alternative route, which is if you're not an Amazon purchaser, then we'd love for you to consider going up and to BeHereNowNetwork.com. And there's a support button or a donate button link. And you can just, if you just do like a $9 a month thing, that again will be super, super helpful. And all of this goes to the support for everybody who puts all this stuff together for the network, and also for us to be able to share with the teachers. I mean, there's a lot of wisdom on this network. Jack Kornfield, Sharon Salzberg, Krishnadas, Ramdas, Joseph Goldstein, Lama Suryadas, on and on and on. I mean, we keep adding people and so on. And it's a real enterprise that needs your support. So please either check out and bookmark the Amazon link, or go and see what you can do about a little donation. Even a one-time is good. So here we go. This is Annie Lamott. Again, I can't emphasize how great this woman is, and a New York Times bestseller. She's got a bunch of books out there. You just go check out Annie Lamott. Just Google her up. And or look on the page. We're going to have, the page that this podcast will reside at on Be Here Now Network. And you will get links to all this stuff. So here we go. Annie Lamott and all around her new book, Hallelujah Anyway.
Hi, everyone. It's Mind Rolling on the Be Here, Ramdas's Be Here Now Network. And today I am visiting with somebody named Annie Lamott. Annie, so happy to have you here. Although you've been here before, not on this one, but we have mutual friend, Dale Borgman, Ramdev. And everybody, there are many people out there that have probably already tuned into that particular podcast. But this is going to be a good one because of the subject matter. Now, I feel like I don't really know Annie, but I really know Annie. And I know her through her work, through her words. And which to me, Annie, I was in the music business for a long time. And that was a big part of my life, always has been. And so I've always, you know, how you can really connect with someone who is really expressing their soul in a song and or an artist through a painting or whatever. And Annie, everybody out there who does not know Annie Lamott, Annie does this so fabulously through her work, expresses her soul. So I just, to me, it's a real gift, and I'm really grateful and honored to have you on the show, Annie.
Thank you.
So, okay. Annie's coming out with a book. By the way, Annie has many, many books for you all. We're gonna put them up on the page so everybody can have a gander at some of the work that Annie has done in the past. So when this podcast is up, you'll be able to access all of that. But the new book is called Hallelujah Anyway. And the subtitle is Rediscovering Mercy. So here we have a word that is really a no-no. I mean, when Ramdas came back from India the first time after he had met Neem Karoli Baba, and he started lecturing and giving talks around. And some of them, they started out with, well, I have a few dirty words here that I'm going to be talking about that are going to be very hard for you to grasp. Surrender, let's start there, he said. Let's go on to devotion. And I think mercy is one of those words, is it not? And so I'd love for you to just give us an idea of a definition of mercy.
Yeah, well, first of all, I've loved Ram Dass my whole life. I feel like he's my brother in all this, as most people who have read him and met him feel. Mercy for me means kindness, loving kindness and grace and generosity and forgiveness. I'd say those are all synonyms. Grace I've always described as being spiritual WD-40, but it's also water wings that give you a little buoyancy when you think you're going down, or a second wind when you're really all used up. And I think grace is that loving divine energy that surrounds us and indwells us. And I think maybe mercy is the action word that goes along with mercy, because to show mercy, to show forgiveness and loving kindness and generosity, and to receive it, which is so much harder, is more of an action. Whereas grace is, I think, the stuff we're made of and the stuff that we are surrounded by, saved by, created in. And I've always said grace bats last. But I think mercy is the action step of grace.
Very well put. So in one of the things, I think this is, it may be from the book, but maybe not. It just came along with the book that was sent to me. But it's definitely from you. I am not sure I even recognize the ever presence of mercy anymore. The divine and the human, the messy, crippled, transforming, heartbreaking, lovely, devastating presence of mercy. But I have come to believe that I am starving to death for it, and my world is too. Boy, does that ring loud and true in the times that we are in right now? And that leads me to the question, did you plan to write this book because you knew that Trump was going to be elected and we would have this thing on our hands?
I had a 0%. I had a belief that there was a 0% chance Trump would be elected. So that just goes to show. But I had started, I wrote this book by accident. I was sort of tired of publishing and tired of the sound of my own voice. I'd published 4 books, Stitches, Help, Thanks, Wow, Some Assembly Required, and Small Victories, sort of back to back. And so I was on book tour all the time. And I didn't want to publish. I didn't want to go out on book tour. And this book kept tugging on my sleeve of my heart. And I noticed that if I thought of or said the words mercy or merciful, it changed people and it changed me, because it reminded me that in the face of the global catastrophe of climate change and of evil and of, the devastating, grinding poverty that most people live under, there's also mercy. And for someone like me, who's sort of OCD and easily overwhelmed, if I were in charge, or if I were God's West Coast representative, I would have things in a very organized system. So you'd have all the awful, scary, bad things in the fork drawer and I'd have in the knife drawer, I'd have all the beautiful, benevolent, healing things. And then where the soup spoons go, I would have things that just filled you with wonder and amazement. And it's not like that. It's all marbled in together, the extraordinary beauty and preciousness of these lives and our breath and our awareness here and our friends and our family and nature and community, and marbled in with extremely painful stuff that happens to people, and the awfulness of some people's hearts, the coldness and maybe just the wound and damage of some people's hearts that causes them to act out aggressively and in terms of dominating and in terms of greed and whatnot. So I started to think about these two words, and that's why, accidentally, the next thing I knew, I thought, wow, does that change my day in the face of all this to even think that? And I started off thinking of the book as being called The Open Drawer. No, that was the title, yeah. Because I think that when we're little, we have it all. We have mercy and awareness. We have wonder. And little kids give it all away. Like, you make him a sandwich. I live with a 7-year-old. I make him sandwiches for school, and he gives them to the kid who didn't bring anything, you know. And you say, no, no, don't give away your lunch. Share it, you know. But little kids that's their nature. That's our nature. But at a very early age, like 4 or 5, our parents and the society and the teachers start saying, no, no, put that away. Don't be silly. We've got to get more focused on your own reading skills and your own math level and getting ahead and achieving. And I was in the 50s. Are you 60 yet? You look much younger.
Thank you so much.
In the 60s, I mean, in the 50s when I was coming up, there was a book called The Overly Sensitive Child. And all the parents who were burdened with a child like me, whose hearts were very open, were given special tools to help them help their kid have more armor and thicker skin. And so you were taught to put away this dearness, sweetness, open-heartedness, and to become more assertive. And people said things like, my parents forgot to say, oh, it's wonderful to be exactly the way you are. That's why I tell my Sunday school kids, you are loved and chosen and safe. And what my parents said instead was, when you do certain things, it makes all of us happy. And what they said was, oh, for Christ's sake, Annie, now what? Because I was so sensitive. You couldn't take me to the pound. We had a National Geographic subscription, which you couldn't leave around, because I would see what India was like for its children. And so I thought about all the stuff that we put away because grown-ups said we'd be more attractive and it make the family look better. And so I thought about opening the drawer and just getting it all back out, you know, getting that crazy radical generosity back and getting back that silliness and that wonder and that realization that if somebody else doesn't have a sandwich, it breaks your heart. And it's good breaking your heart. It's like Carly Simon saying, there's more room in a broken heart, you know? So I was thinking about it as this drawer in which all of the truth of my spiritual identity got put into. And I just got the drawer back out and started putting it back inside of me. And then I felt like this was one of the ways that old aging hippie leftist activists could help save the world, is to have people start being more merciful to themselves as a starting point.
More sandwiches being shared for sure would be a great thing.
Yeah.
And actually your description just then, if people want, people talk about being on the spiritual path and taking Buddhist teachings or bhakti teachings and doing all of the different practices to get where, you know, that everyone has a little bit of enlightenment or whatever it is, as far as they will think they can go, or how they put that word together where it means something. And I just loved what you just said, Annie, about it. Just the real purpose is around being able to be kind, being able to be a little bit compassionate and share that sandwich, that we could just get there, you know.
Yeah.
Forget all the highfalutin stuff.
Yeah. Well, it's uh-oh, sorry, my phone's ringing. I was trying to turn it off. I'm not very mechanical. there's two sandwich things that I think are the total secret of life. One is what Warren Zevon said at the end of his life, and he said that having a terminal illness helped him to really appreciate each sandwich. And in terms of being here now and awareness and, you know, being where your butt is, you could also, I love sandwiches. They're probably my main food. And to enjoy each sandwich and to share what you have, you know, to give it away as a way of filling up and giving it away as a way of finding the true wealth of having being a warm-hearted being here.
If you don't mind, I love reading some of the passages from the book as I found them. And by the way, usually because I'm a little, everyone's completely preoccupied with their work and their lives and so on and so forth. But in my podcast life, which is part of my work, when I get a book and I'm going to talk to somebody about them, I never can read the whole book. I just don't have the time. You know, usually there's a few days, maybe, you know, and they're stacked up on my desk and all around. And I go through it and I find things that attract me that I think would be, you know, great to explicate to everybody and share with everybody. I could not do that with your book.
Oh, thank you. Let's just take one second while I yell at the dog. Ladybird, there's no one there. There's no one there.
That's not
going to
work.
Okay. Ladybird. Ladybird. It will. She'll realize in a minute that it was all in her head, as most of our problems are. Well, thank you for saying that you finished it. That means a lot to me.
So what I starting at the very beginning of what it sounds like, what or a who prompted you around mercy, and I just want to read. More often than not, the North Star that guides me through the darkness is the Old Testament prophet Micah. And that was like news to me, Annie. I mean, I'm now I got to start reading Micah. He must have looked like a complete stoner or a Game of Thrones extra, and smelled like a goat. Yet nearly 3,000 years ago, he spoke the words that often remind me of my path and purpose. What doth God require of thee but to do justice and to love mercy and to walk humbly with thy God? Now, that I'm taking, that's the inspiration ultimately for this book.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. But almost all wisdom traditions have said words to the same effect, that that we trust God, you know, we, as much as possible, surrender and release. Not my strong suit, but we surrender and release, and we unfurl our hands, and we try to breathe, and that we be people of generosity. And that most wisdom traditions say the same thing: that if you want to feel okay and safe and filled up, give it all away. And that we walk humbly with God, which is, again, not my strong suit. I think in the next sentence from what you read, I said, "It's humility is not my strong suit, and my humility kick your humility's butt." But that's the dream. That's the goal. And that's the North Star, is to realize how little we're in charge of and how like everybody else we really are. And to stop the train of trying to get people to think you're more impressive than you are, because they don't anyway, if they're even thinking about you. So what's the point?
Everyone is completely lost in their own movie. It's not. Talking about mercy is radical kindness, and I love that phrase too. And mercy, grace, forgiveness, and compassion are synonyms. Talk about that a little bit, because I think that's extraordinarily important, that they really are the components of that word, which I have never used before. And I myself might, if someone had used it with me in conversation, I would go, mercy, because of the Judeo-Christian interpretation that I have in my little mind. And I left all of that to go to the East, you know, and that's mm-hmm. just, mm-hmm. it's more BS that, it's not any kind of real mm-hmm. thing. So now I'm reading it, and I'd like you to just really talk about the components that make up this word.
Well, it comes from a Greek word, misere, but now I can't quite, I think that means a heart for someone else's troubles. And in this modern era, there's so much to do and so much coming in and so much pummeling us. And most people are multitasking, and they kind of have their telecommunications empire with them at all times and all of that. And it's hard to notice that people are in such doubt and fear and grief and overwhelm, and to stop and say to them that you actually have a minute to, how can you serve them? So that I can tell you my mercy story from last Sunday with my Sunday school kids. It's a tiny sort of failing church. And so I usually have a few kids, and they could be anywhere from 7 to 18. And all in one room. I had 3 9-year-olds, and it's Lent right now, which all wisdom traditions celebrate the return of the light and the resurrection and the wildflowers and the bulbs. So I said to the kids, let's make a contract till I see you again for this week. And let's focus it on mercy. Well, we immediately were talking about how easy it is to be sweet and forgiving with people that do something to you that they probably didn't mean to do, but hurt you. But with ourselves, we cross our arms and we cut off all communication. We cut ourselves off from the great shalom when we harsh ourselves. And so the first thing we were going to do was to be with ourselves the way we would be with a friend. And the second thing was that we were going to each fill a box of for Goodwill or Salvation Army of art supplies and toys, right? I mean, talk about what grace looks like, or mercy. And the third thing we were going to do was every day we're going to tell one very old person that we love their clothes, especially if they had hats on. It's been raining a lot out here. And so those were the three things. We're going to talk to ourselves like we were with our friends, watch the self-talk. We were going to fill a box with art supplies and toys for children. And we were going to tell very old people that we loved their clothes. And that's what mercy and loving kindness and grace and it all look like. They, you know, the Bible says many times in different ways that it's about action. It's not about thinking really darling thoughts. And it's not about, it's not that there's no code to break. You know, there's not going to be a point at which you've broken the spirit code and all of a sudden you're in kind of very calm euphoria most of the time. It's about taking the action of love and then the insight follows. So if you're having a bad day and you want to have loving feelings, you do loving things. It's really simple. And every wisdom tradition, pretty much many of them, say that. So I'm not sure that wisdom, that compassion, loving kindness, mercy are all synonyms, but they're sort of synonyms-ish, you know? There, if you say one, I know what you're talking about. Now, when I was a child, you could also use the words the common good or fair or fairness without being mocked, and you can't anymore. But just because they're no longer valid, you know, honored, doesn't mean we can't start using them again. We know, you know, if you say the word fair, oh, whoever said the world would be fair. Or people say, oh, fair is where the pony rides are, you know, as if that's helpful. But I know what fair is. You know what fair is. And you know what the common good is. It's sort of a communist or socialist idea that from all to all, and that we got it all from someone. and we share it all as freely as it was shared with us. So,
you know, the way you engage with something that's really important to me, it's something that, and I'll refer back to Ram Dass when I first met him. I was just actually working last night talking to people around a new online course that we're doing around aging, called Aging into Awakening. And I said, you know, one extraordinarily important thing is how honest you can be with yourself. And when I first was attracted to Ram Dass, when I first heard the first talks, and I went, it was actually in Montreal, and I was a program director of a rock and roll radio station, and they wanted me to promote him, and I said, like, who's that? And they finally sent me a tape if you want me to do it. Of course, I knew who Richard Alpert and Tim Leary were very well. And in it, the self-honesty that he had, the willingness to share all of his foibles and all of his shortcomings, and it immediately, of course, made me feel like I wasn't crazy. That was number one. And number two, it just created a complete spacious ground from which I could then actually enter into a stream that made good sense in terms of a real path I could follow. So that was an extremely important mm-hmm. thing. And in this book, and I'm going to read this one thing, because you are pretty self-honest throughout the book and throughout all your books, of course, and all your writing. My unloveliness, on the other hand, is always on tap, like draft beer. My boring self-obsession, pettiness, and schadenfreude. Wearing my bad pair of glasses, I look around and see that I am surrounded by swine. How do you expect me to react? Boy, talk about relating with something. But God, in her guise, as coyote trickster, gooses me and I accidentally let go. I take a break from being prickly and judgmental. I stop, pull back, take a breath. The next thing I know, I let others go first, or see that perhaps now is not the time to demand an explanation or an apology. Against all odds, I'll somehow stop the campaign for now. I'll start over. I start over. I'm able to keep the patient, more patient, and I get me back. I could have written that if I could write like you, I mean, about myself in that situation and about a million other people as well. So let's talk about, how about a little mercy for ourselves first? Can you talk about that? I mean, before.
Well, I think that's where it all begins. And I write a lot about that in the book, that it's relatively easy to extend mercy to almost everyone. And, you know, there's some people that are pretty challenging, that might be a neighbor or relative or an ex. But the hardest person of all to do the forgiveness and the self-care, the care for is ourselves, because we know what we're really like on the inside. And everybody thinks we're just so sweet and giving and adorable. And we know on the inside that we're just deeply human. And that means flawed and, you know, mealy mouth and kind of worried. And so for me, what I was saying is I can't just think this, and I need to share it, like whether it's with my 9-year-old church school kids or with a brother or a friend in recovery or somebody at my church. I need to say, I'm just really being so mean to myself about this stupid mistake I made. And almost anybody will say, upon hearing this, upon a little truth telling, will say, oh, me too. I do that too. I've done that too. I thought that this morning and I called someone and it was healed, or it was, I got my sense of humor back, you know. And I've always said that laughter is carbonated holiness. And when we can get our sense of humor about ourselves back, we're home free. And it's not about figuring out something else, a new thing. Figure it out is not a good slogan. But you take the action. What can I do for myself right now? I'm starting to get a little hungry, I want to warn you. I would love a new pair of socks for the book tour. It doesn't always take money. I can take a really hot bath because I'm getting older and things hurt and things are not working nearly as well as they did once. And I can take an action that I would take for you. And I've never seen you before, you know, and if you were here and you were hungry, I would feed you. That's what Jesus says. Go get everybody some water. You know, go, do you have some food? Share it. And very simple stuff. And I would say, look, do you want me to draw you a bath? My son has Epsom salts in his bathroom. I can make you a hot. I would automatically know how to care for you. And I think that's those same gestures of those same expressions, let's say, of love and grace are what we're so starved for. And we want the bright, the perfect person to come along and bestow those things upon us. Mm-hmm. And the perfect person is us. And if we're starving for this stuff and we bring it to ourselves and it exists, it's in the same room we were in when we thought we were missing it. Mm. It was actually there all along in this distressing guise as ourselves.
The distressing guise of ourselves. Hey, there's a great story in the book I'd love for you to tell that points this out. Is a true way of giving and receiving it in the same moment. And that's the story of your friend Tom and Terry, and they mm-hmm. they went off to a shelter, I believe. And can you tell that story?
Yeah, they're both priests. Tom is the I've written so much about him. Tom Weston, my Jesuit friend, and he had just gotten sober. And there was a Franciscan priest in L.A. who was going to take him to a gathering of other alcoholics. It was Tom's like first week, and so he was just a mess. He was hypersensitive, like a burn victim. He hated everyone. He didn't want to get sober. He thought he could just work with the disease for a few more weeks and get it to work better and have a cool, refreshing beer with breakfast once again. But instead, he was with his priest friend, and they were walking up the stairs to where the other men were. It was right next to a shelter, and it was men who were there to support people getting sober in this male shelter. And the man in front of him got violently ill from both ends. And Tom was trapped on the stairs halfway up with people crowding him and pushing him upward, and then people up above the sick man. And it was just a nightmare. It was like, if you're OCD, the single most terrifying thing is for somebody else's effluvia to get on you when you're only a few days sober, when you most are kind of vaguely suicidal and very, very tense. So it's a story of how this older man, the Franciscan, helped him through it. And what he did was to get help for the sick man. And what he did was to ask for people who would help the man who was covered in various fluids, would get him clean clothes, share their own clothes with him, take him next door to the shelter, wash him, wash his clothes, give him something to eat, make him a cup of tea. And what Terry, the Franciscan, said to the man at the moment when he was so violently and flagrantly ill was, it looks like you need a little help. And, you know, can I help you? And then if you can get there, everything falls into place. And because the man couldn't say, no, I'm fine. He was so beyond being able to do what we mostly do is say, oh, no, I'm fine. And then it gave all these other men the chance to serve and to help and to be instruments of God's peace. And I wrote another story about a woman who helped me get sober 30 years ago named Loretta towards the end of the book. And what I said was that I thought I was a hotshot when I got sober. I had 3 or 4 books published. I was a speaker. I'd born and raised in the same county, so I'm sort of loved out of all sense of proportion. And I came into sobriety thinking I was a hotshot, and I learned and was taught slowly how to be a servant. And that was where I found happiness. That was where I found myself, and that was where I found union with God. So
beautiful.
Thank you.
We've talked a little bit about unfolding, which is actually, I think it's the last chapter, if I'm not mistaken, the open drawer. I think it's good to share with everybody how some of the ways in which we are folded up. We talked a little bit about it before, and maybe this is something to strike off on that theme. From the book, we get militarized to the beat of someone else's anxiety. I mean, you know, some of this stuff, Annie, I mean, talk about relating with, and I just, you write this stuff, I see suddenly my father is right in front of my eye. Oh, God. Militarized to the beat of someone else's anxiety. Original need to get warped. It became too expensive to pay attention to our own bodies. We looked to the metronome of other needs, of others' needs. We became serenely attached or anxiously attached or unable to attach at all. As Beckett wrote, we were too bonny once. Yeah. The bonniness is easy at first. Many things are easy at first. If you were hungry, you were usually fed. Skin was flawless. Diaper got changed, hopefully before you got a rash. You were nuzzled, sniffed with joy, or amused horror. We'd already started to complain, but pretty quickly as we got bigger, we learned to shove it down because someone didn't like it and seemed to like us less. Mm. And then our needs didn't get met. And we learned to put on happy faces like makeup. I mean, this stuff is really bringing me back into a moment. I can't tell you, just reading it now. We learned to put on happy faces like makeup and to fake feeling okay about ourselves and our family in order to please everyone and thus survive. I mean, it's painful to read this and just realize every one of us comes with this gigantic wound. Talk about that a little bit.
I hear that there are people who don't relate to that and who had a pretty easy time of it, but I'm not close to any of them. And I wouldn't be able to have a meal with them because it would just be so pointless. Like, what would we talk about? And the people that I trust and am really safe with and am growing with and am evolving with and doing the work with are all people, the Me Too people, who I share something like this with, and they don't go, well, that's horrible. I had a very happy, healthy childhood. They don't say that, never once. They say, you know, me too. I did too. I was scared to death the whole time. I was dancing as fast as I could. I had a very severe addiction to people pleasing by 4 years old. It was how I felt of value. I've written about this a lot, but I had migraines by 5 and I was lying on the floor of bathrooms, putting my head on the tile in kindergarten to cool down. And girls would come into the bathroom and I was so shamed. And one of the ways I dealt with the shame and the isolation and the feeling that I was defective was, of course, to obsess about other people and to try to save and fix and rescue them so that I would feel better about myself. And I just got farther and farther away from my own truth. And so to talk about this, there'll be some people who say, oh, don't dwell on it. And I say, thank you so much for sharing. And I would never feel safe around that person. But if I shared it with somebody that was doing some of the same spiritual psychological work, they would say, I think it's true for almost everyone we know. And where do we even start? Well, you start by being aware of it. You always start with awareness of it. Usually, certainly in recovery from food or addiction or codependence or gambling or whatever, it's the willingness to change comes from the pain of not changing. It comes from the pain of the shame and the obsession. And you finally get to that point where you go, okay, I'm good. I'm in, now what? And so to be aware of it and then to start to accept it and to go, wow, everyone I'm close to has the same thing. They've thought the same things. They've done the same things. They've tried the same things and it didn't work for them. It didn't work for me when I was 5, trying to get the grown-ups and especially the grown-up males to feel better about themselves, to try to get the grown-up males to feel better about the catastrophe of their own behavior. That is actually what I'm best at, is to kind of jolly them and coddle them. And, you know, in the 50s and 60s, what girls were taught to say was, you said to men, can I get you a plate, right? Like the men shouldn't even have to go get their own plate of food at the holiday buffet. The girls got, can I get you a plate? And then the men loved and valued you more. And that's very addictive. That's mood altering. And So I think you, the awareness and the pain of not growing, not healing, is what gets you willing to do this work. And then the acceptance of it's a long way back from having been turned, you know, pretzelized by the culture, by teachers, by parents. And I'm in. Mm. This is why I think I was born, was to find my way back to God and to find union with my true self and that little child inside of me, and in the faces of everyone around me and in my dog. You know, I've said frequently that I think the closest we come on this side of eternity to knowing the direct love of God is with our dogs and cats, although the cats can be so bitter. But I think that's why I'm here. So it's not like I'm really late to the party or that I'll never catch up. It's like turning a switch on. It's like, okay, I'm here. Now where do we go?
Yeah.
Maybe a hot bath, maybe a new pair of socks. Maybe since my grandson isn't here, I can eat his ice cream bars and there will be no consequence. There will not be a grim and unhappy 50-pound person glaring at me. You know, I don't know what union with myself will look like today, but I can ask myself, and I can ask myself the way I would ask you, well, how can I serve you? What do you need today? Are your feet really sore? I know what, we'll get a really warm bucket of Epsom salt water. I've written a lot about my obsession over the years with weight, and how my first 12 years I didn't weigh enough. And this was commented on frequently by strangers and comments to my parents like, what the? Oh, don't you feed her? Well, I was perfect. I was a perfectly healthy child. I was a tennis star. I was thin. Then at about 13, I got fat. And so then I got all the other side of it all. And, you know, and I didn't notice how angry that was making me, that the whole world, especially the male world, would have so many thoughts and so many shaming projections onto me about my body, my thighs, my whatever, my hair. And I was bullied mercilessly. And I didn't realize that everybody that was bullied or isolated or really, really different had the same wound, because you weren't supposed to share it, because then everybody would know what a total loser you were. Thank God when the women's movement comes along and I'm about 16 and women are saying, we're here, we have been wounded beyond all imagining, and guess what? We're really mad. I have a friend who's not with us anymore, Pat Fitzpatrick, Pat, and she said, if you're a girl over the age of 12 in America and you're not really angry, you've missed the boat. You know, and the women's liberation movement said to me, we're here, we're going to stick together. We're not about what our bodies look like. We're about our souls. We're about our spirits. We're about our minds. We're going to start telling the truth. And yes, we're mad. And yes, we're available for the resurrection, the non-Christian sense. And we're going to tell each other stories, and we're going to listen to yours. You want to see? Yeah. You know, and that's what's so crazy about becoming a spiritual seeker or becoming one with God or with other women, is that God is saying to you, look, you can have total acceptance from all goodness, all divine mind, all universal intelligence. You can be spiritually fed. You can be loved and chosen and safe. Or you can continue trying to break the code and trying to get all these people in the world to think that you're like the most incredible, amazing person. And you don't go, oh, I want the love and the God and the, you go, you know, can I get back to you on that? Am I willing to give up, you know, my book doing really well, or getting my weight to the perfect place, or, you know, getting this or that to look better, you know, to get my surfaces burnished. It's like, can I get back to you on that? But the willingness comes from the pain. And I think once you're in, you know, it's hard to go back. Like when I'm with a young alcoholic, I can wreck it for them, because I have them tell me the truth of what their drinking was like. And they can't get that toothpaste back in the tube. I read my first Ram Dass book when I was 22. I think it was The Only Dancer Is, right before my dad got brain cancer. And, it wrecked everything. It wrecked not being a seeker for me, because it was so funny. It was carbonated holiness, and it was food, and it was water, and it was myself. It was a neurotic, loving, beautiful, damaged, be human, merely being, as E.E. Cummings puts it. And I wanted it. I tasted the living water. And it doesn't come where we expect it, you know? And it came for me that day. And I've written about that day because it was actually, it's a long story in another book. But anyway, you can't not unfeel what you felt when somebody got in deep into your soul and they said, this is actually who you are. And I know that because this is who I really am. And this is where God really is with us, with two of us, in the breath, in the heart, in the truth. And do you want this or do you want to get back to me on this? And I had to get back to God on that. But I couldn't get Ram Dass to quit bugging me and in my heart, in what he calls the heart cave. It was like, yeah, I've got the same stuff you've got. And I found a way one day at a time through love and service and prayer and meditation to heal. And I needed to get sober about 8 years after I read my first Ram Dass book. And then how could I go back? I tasted it. I know why I'm here. I know what I have to offer. I can get you a glass of water. That's really all I have to offer.
Got to have that sandwich.
And a sandwich.
I've been put off sandwiches for a month for cholesterol reasons, and I'm dying. A piece of toast or a sandwich. That's you talk in one little place. Here's another beautiful little. I mean, the book is so full of. I don't want to be too effusive. Okay, that's
effusive.
But I have to be.
That's okay. I'll look away. I'll look away for a moment.
This is about mercy as a cloak. It taught me that mercy is a cloak that will wrap around you and protect you. It can block the terror, the dark, and most terrifying aspects of your own true self. It is soft, has lots of folds, and enfolds you. It can help you rest and breathe again for the time being, which is all we ever have, our present moment. I think this is because we talked about, you know, the things that give us the wounds early in our life and the roles that we are shoved into. And then we talk about how we wake up because of the pain at some point is just absolutely too overwhelming not to wake up. And we wake up. And then we need little methods and little reminders and little exercises to allow us to be able to operate on a day-to-day basis in the world. And I think that bringing in this idea of cloaking yourself, and I like the components of mercy, of compassion, kindness, forgiveness. I like that idea that's mercy. I mean, this is a whole new definition for me now. As I said before, mercy was not a word that I would have chosen in any which way to use in this respect, which is why when I saw the book, and I wanted to talk to you about it because it just set me in a completely 360 about mercy. And so I think that you should give us a few other little tidbits of what are the things, little actionable items, like thinking of mercy as a cloak in that moment that you can just breathe into that gives us some kind of spaciousness. So I ask you for some other little clues to allow ourselves to come back to ourselves.
Well, paradoxically, I think that one of the ways I come back to myself, a lot of people come back through breath, and that's sometimes available as a way to reestablish that umbilical connection to God and universe. But it's so amazing to let yourself or kind of goad yourself into picking up the 300-pound phone and asking someone if they have a minute. And then the truth is how we find our way home. And we don't say to someone, oh, I'm great. How are you? We say, I feel very sad and overwhelmed, and I'm kind of down on myself, and I can't remember where we even start. And they might say, you did it. You called me. You called love. You know, when you called me, you called love. There's a story about being in a kind of a fancy women's boutique franchise. I don't know if you remember it. And thinking that what I needed was to shop and to do the retail therapy and to buy a cute sweater. And what I really needed was to call a girlfriend and say, I'm just nuts. I'm nuts and I'm an awful person. And she said, oh, I'm so glad you called. And she kind of teased me. She said, oh, we're all concerned about you. And then she'd say, you know, wherever you are, sit down. Well, then the saleswoman brings me this tiny cup of water that I said in the book you would serve to a cat, a tiny, hilariously small cup of water. Then I've got the water. Water is often involved with us finding our way back home because we're made of water. We grew in water. We marinated in water. We return to something like water and flow. And so for me, it involves glasses of water. It involves warm ocean water. It involves hot water. And it involved this tiny symbol of water that the saleswoman, and I was home talking to a friend who was making me laugh and then having this symbol of water. I'll tell you this trippy thing. Once in my pastor, Veronica, was giving the children a sermon, which we don't do anymore. And she said, I want you to close your eyes and listen. And I want you to tell me everything you hear. One kid, I heard a siren a minute ago. Oh, I heard a dog barking. Oh, I heard somebody's shoes scraping. And then this four-year-old boy named Tommy said, I hear water at the edge of all things. And I thought, that's Einstein. You know, that is time and space. And I hear water at the edge of all things. So anyway, for me to find my way back to my truth and myself and my heart cave, God and that little child often involves getting myself a cup of tea. I put water on for tea. My mother was from Liverpool, and tea was usually the solution to about 90%, and somebody making you a cup of tea is what the divine face of God looks like. And I believe, as a person with cellulite, and I have a real body, and I had a baby almost 28 years ago, and then I somehow forgot to go to the gym afterwards, and I certainly mean to, and probably will as soon as we finish this interview, but I have cellulite. I have this little fanny pack that's really warm and welcoming, and children love it, and my partner loves it, and he buries his head in my little, it's a very welcoming and warm tummy, but it's not a real swimsuit tummy, let's say. It's not a real swimsuit with strangers tummy. And so what I do, since I believe in swimming in warm water as a radical act, every single chance you get on this mortal coil, I'll go in and I'll show myself the tummy, and I'll say, oh, let's put some lotion on that. And I'll put a really delicious smelling lotion, because then it's kind of aromatherapy too. It's aromatherapy and it's a laying on of hands, right? It's a priestess rubbing lotion into the tummy. And then I might put a little decal. My grandchild has a lot of decals around, and I might put the Power Ranger decal on my tummy, or I might put a rose, or I might draw a little rose on my tummy. And then, like, who cares what some stranger thinks about you when you're about to plunge into the salty umbilical oneness of the ocean? Who cares? Well, I kind of do, but day by day with a lot of love, I care less. So it's always, you take the action. What would I offer to a girlfriend who came over in a place of rejecting her body? I'd say, ooh, let's take off our shirts, okay? And let's put lotion on our arms, and let's go get manicures. Let's go get pedicures. Oh, let me give you this crazy glittery nail polish I have. That's what I did the week of the inauguration. Yeah. I went and I got a crazy glittery nail polish. I'll tell you why. And I have to go in a minute because I'm really hungry. But I went to get a little nail polish, because that is the laying on of hands, and it's turning something. I have the hands of like a dock worker, which my grandfather in Liverpool was. And so I went to get, well, right now, I'll hold them up. I have this beautiful light pink nail polish on for my little girl inside who loves this. But the week of the inauguration, I went and I sat down in the salon, and there was a woman of enormous size and sturdiness and joy sitting next to me. I mean, she looked if God is a woman, she looked just exactly like God. I think if God is a man, he might look like Isaac Stern. And if a woman, either Bette Midler or the woman I was sitting next to, and she was in such joy, and she was getting this crazy nail polish with confetti. And she said, I'm a lot older than you, and I'm 100 pounds heavier, and I teach dance. And I know that Friday is going to be a very, very day, hard day for me and all of my friends. So I'm getting this confetti nail polish so that I can think, no matter what happens, I can still dance. And so I got that. So I thought, you know what? That's the ultimate hallelujah anyway story, right? I mean, just to kind of wrap it up, is that Trump is being inaugurated and Jeff Sessions and this and that and the other. But you know what? Hallelujah anyway. And look at these beautiful nails. And I thought about that happy, happy woman who I think God sent to me. I think God looked through a Rolodex and found this dance teacher and sent her to me. And we sat together and we did laying on of hands. And I got me back. I got my joy back. I got my breath back. And I got these incredible nails.
Wow. Yes. Being open to every moment is a wonderful message to wake up, for sure. Beautiful.
Yeah.
And also thank in this you. Book, you talk a lot. I know you got to go. But mercy and grace and the connectivity of those, that the grace of, for me, the grace of mercy now newly defined for me as a real purpose for being here, and the Buddhists would call it bodhisattva,
right.
Is that is true grace. And I that's why I love that story of your two Jesuit priest friends. He was,
yeah.
What do you do when you're just forced? I mean, it was right in front of them, right in front of him. Never mind that he was a priest.
Right,
yeah,
right.
He had just come out.
Right.
Yeah, and
right.
Never mind, he'd just come out of, you know, abstinence. He recovery. He just
recovery,
had
yeah.
to act from the deepest part of himself. And that mercy
right.
is
right.
is total grace. And, yeah, so wonderful book, Annie. Really, 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 really love it.
Thank
and,
you, honey.
Really happy to share it
you.
With everybody. And where can people find you? They can find you, you know, I found you on Facebook. I mean, just
well,
follow Annie.
See, I have a lot of technological problems. My son, who's 27, always says to me, Mom, don't let people see you try to do things because I can't work. I can work old fashioned. I can work landlines, but if you go to Facebook, which I don't, I have a writer's page, but I don't actually interact. I write pieces there and schedules are there if you want to see if I'm anywhere near you. If you put in Anne Lamott, I think it goes through my page. And I have a Twitter thing that often links to the Facebook at Anne Lamott. And I have an Instagram, and I think it's at Anne Lamott. And that's how people tell me they can
well,
find
well, definitely
me.
Follow Annie on Twitter or Facebook because the wonderful posts that they do, I mean, I look for them all the time. And by the way, so Annie's going on tour, and
awesome.
You're going to be on tour in April. And you're going to, everybody,
yep.
just go to BeHereNowNetwork.com/mindrolling. And you go to the page, and we're going to put all that information, and we're going to have a link to the book. We're going to have everything going on there so that, because it's not, I mean, I do podcasts with authors and so on, and I'm always fairly enthusiastic, but I'm way more enthusiastic in this moment, and because I think that given the times that we're in, and, you know, I wish we had another 2 or 3 hours to talk about how we can actually actuate what mercy really represents so that we are not hating anybody, including those that we think did something maybe not so
right.
smart. Or yeah.
We're loving. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, my pastor always closes her services by saying, God bless you good.
Yes,
so I'll leave you with that. And thank you so much. I loved spending an hour with you. And Ram Dass, I love you so much. I am so here with you and for you for the rest of our
you.
Lives.
I'll convey your wishes to him, Annie, and I look forward to doing this again sometime, okay?
Okay.
This is Mind Rolling on the Be Here Now Network. Go to BeHereNowNetwork.com, and we'll see you next week.